In the winter of 1854, the discovery of lakeshore settlements in Switzerland from the Neolithic and Bronze Age triggered the beginning of European pile-dwelling research. Only a few months before that, a likewise exceptionally well-preserved feature, namely a wooden spring tapping, had come to light at the mineral spring in St. Moritz. In this case, however, nobody recognized the value at the time. The spring of this highly carbonated and red-colored mineral water is consecrated to Saint Mauritius and not only gave St. Moritz its name, but also made it world famous as a health resort since the end of the Middle Ages. The chemical composition of the mineral spring also fulfills today's criteria for rational therapy. Modern tourism reached its peak in the second half of the 19th and the beginning of the 20th century, which repeatedly led to recurring renovation and construction work at the mineral spring. In 1907, the spring tapping was to be completely renewed for the first time. At the bottom of the spring, age-old looking metal finds were made. Thanks to interested and committed people present, the age and uniqueness of the finds were recognized right away. Jakob Hayoli, then lecturer in pre- and proto-history at the University of Zurich and secretary of the Swiss Society for Prehistory, was asked to come to St. Moritz and take care of the finds. From the beginnings, there was a great response to this discovery in both the public and the professional world. Also thanks to the archaeological reports which were published immediately. For more than 100 years, the St. Moritz spring tapping from the Bronze Age has been regarded as a prime example in terms of alpine sacrifices, sanctuaries with a water context, and the sacrificial interpretation of Gewässerfunde, or in general, single finds made of metal. This is not surprising since the sacrificial component of this complex is unambiguous in the relationship between water and valuable metal finds and exceptionally clearly archaeologically comprehensible. Therefore, it has been included in just about all relevant publications on these research topics. While many authors dealt with the question of how the spring water may have been used and embedded in sacrificial processes, nobody discussed the hydrotechnical functionality of the spring tapping system. In 2001, the first successful dendrochronological analysis was achieved, dating the construction to the end of the Middle Bronze Age. In 2012, the citizens of St. Moritz approved the renovation of a drinking hall in the spa district, which was built in 1864 and is now called Forum Paracelsus, and the newly conceived exhibition of the Bronze Age spring tapping as a centerpiece of this building. The relocation of the monumental wooden structure was taken as an opportunity to examine all construction elements as part of my master thesis, which has recently been published in German by the Archaeological Service of Grisons. For 5 years now, the spring tapping has been accessible to visitors in the Forum Paracelsus, like, for example, the participants of our Alpine excursion have experienced. The main structure consisted of a total of 84 individual wooden parts. It included two hollowed out tree trunks, the so-called pipes 1 and 2, which were enclosed by a log construction and a box frame of planks with dovetail joints. It had a trapezoidal ground plan. In addition, there were horizontal planks, so-called lit planks, whose ends had been worked to points and finished off the structure at the top. This ensemble also included a log ladder and, of course, the bronze artifacts. Two metal-hilted swords, which are made in Bavaria, one sword fragment, one dagger, and one pin. In addition, moss remains and sheepskin were preserved. The second ensemble consisted of the so-called pipe number 3 and 4 hooked branches. They were found inside pipe number 3 and can be termed as devices to draw the mineral water. All wooden finds were made of larch, and the estimated maximum weight today is still about 1.5 tons. In order to understand the functionality of the facility, which was the starting point for all further research questions, it was essential to reconstruct the shape and original dimensions of the spring tapping system. This required the relocalization of each individual construction part. In order to be able to identify possible chronological variation, a comprehensive dendrochronological study was also a key focus. The next step was to compare the results of the exact material reconstruction with the existing documentation from 1907 with regard to possible contradictions or similarities. After that, the exact in situ location and orientation of the spring tapping was reconstructed and then examined for coherence with the geological situations. After the different sources had been checked for their validity, the location and composition of the finds could be reconstructed very accurately. The dendrochronological examination revealed two main events. The single pipe number 3, in which the hooks had been found, dated back to the winter season of 1412 or 1411 BC. Apart from some old wood, the trees for the main construction had been felled in the winter season of 1411 or 1410 BC. Thanks to botanical remains within the moss finds and the short vegetarian period of the Upper Engadin Valley, we assume the erection of the main structure took place in the summer of 1410 BC. According to the typological dating of the metal finds, the spring tapping lasted approximately 100 to 150 years at most. On the basis of the new data, the following construction sequence can be proposed. In the winter months of 1412 or 1411 BC, the mineral spring at St. Moritz was tapped by placing a singular hollowed-out tree trunk, pipe number 3, around the area where the iron oxide-laden mineral water emerged naturally. During the spring of 1411 BC, the concentration of the mineral water probably lessened because of a seasonal rise in groundwater levels and increased intermixing of mineral and groundwater. In an attempt to counteract this and achieve a better seal, a construction consisting of two pipes, a catchment basin, which is of course the plank box frame, and a protective lock construction was planned. In order to finally separate the precious mineral water from the groundwater, a water impermeable loam deposit between the mineral and groundwater had to be penetrated. In the winter time of 1411 or 1410 BC, the construction was fully prepared. Now I must confess to you that the geology depicted here does not correspond to the actual one. Taking into account the dimensions of the spring tapping, the flat terrain of the surroundings, and the actual geological stratigraphy, it can be concluded that the Bronze Age people probably misjudged the geological situation. According to my thesis, the stratigraphy you can see on the slides is a situation that Bronze Age people considered to be the case. The new section of the geological situation from the intervention of pipe number 3, but probably assumed that the layers were parallel and therefore horizontal because of the flat terrain. The actual situation looks like this, and also like this for the main construction. The construction that was installed in summertime of 1410 BC was therefore probably not consistent with the plans made in advance. Only pipe number two reached deep enough to penetrate the loam deposit, perhaps only by way of a small penetrating channel, and gain direct access to the moraine material below, through which the mineral water circulated. Therefore, both the two box constructions and pipe number one had become functionally obsolete. Groundwater, even at its lowest, could flow into those parts of the construction. That's why pipe number two offered the only way of accessing the mineral water. This can also be underlined archaeologically. The votive offerings were found exclusively in pipe number two. The inside of pipe number two is also much more iron oxide colored. In addition, the evaluation of the historical sources suggested changes to the material since the middle of the 18th century. These changes were always centered on pipe number two. Unsurprisingly, no comparable spring tapping systems are known, given that even the concept of its construction was tailored to a presumably specific geological situation and was then further customized to match the actual circumstances encountered. The sophisticated construction indicates that the mineral water had to be collected as pure as possible and thus implies the sacrificial character of the mineral water and the whole region. Interestingly, not a single Bronze Age settlement from the Upper Engadin Valley is known to this day. In general, a research gap is argued here. It is true that the Lower Engadin Valley is a climatically more suitable region for establishing settlements and grow cereals and other crops, as is also archaeologically proved for the entire Bronze Age. But is the void of finds in the Upper Engadin Valley just only a research gap, especially considering how many construction projects have already been carried out in the last 100 years in the Upper Engadin Valley? Other explanations will also have to be taken into account. Maybe one could imagine St. Moritz as a form of sacred district, which was only visited and used for ritual purposes in a sporadic way. To see a kind of access to Numen in the highest mineral spring of Europe, which indeed lies away from Bronze Age settlements, should be considered as a possible interpretation of the lack of finds in the upper part of the valley. Especially since there are also supra-regional finds that underline the importance of the site. As a glimpse into the future, another recently made find is presented here. 2 years ago, a Langquaid II type bronze axe was returned to the Archaeological Service of Grisons. It was found on the banks of the river Inn near Ftan in the Lower Engadine Valley and dates back to the early Bronze Age. The site is located only about 100 meters downstream from the so-called Bonifatius mineral spring. It can be assumed that the site is located in an ideal spatial context with the landscape around Schuel Terrasch Pulpera, which is rich in springs. Nevertheless, no finds from the Lower Engadin Valley, which are directly linked to prehistoric mineral spring use, have been made so far. This fact is explained by the narrow steep valley, the resulting landslides, and the displaced spring exits, as a result of which possible corresponding archaeological finds have been covered. The axe of Ftan, Bonifatius Quelle, represents the oldest water discovery from the Engadin Valley and lies about 2 to 3 centuries before the spring finds of St. Moritz. Finally, the new find casts a spotlight on early Bronze Age sacrificial use and thus also the occupation of the Engadin Valley. Further finds will hopefully reveal its exact character. Thank you for your attention.